Our King's Landing set is around about 650 extras.
We had 3 units going, and now at the end, 4. We've been just slammed since day one.
Big telescopic cranes, up to 9 cameras. It was off the scale, really, in every way.
And then we saw the set and what Deb Riley and her team was building, and we just said, wow, this is amazing.
King's Landing traditionally has been Dubrovnik. The thing about Dubrovnik is it's a really beautiful city, and they love it, and they don't want us to, you know, burn it down.
We've had this area out the back of the office. It's been there for, you know, since we ever started here.
It's so close and so easy, and Belfast needs a backlot. Why don't we just call this a backlot and build this set for real?
There's no such thing as a set you can just walk onto and shoot when you're planning on destroying it. There was so much thought that went into every single section because it had so many requirements.
While we were designing the buildings, we were designing the destruction at the same time. So for every lovely drawing of plans and elevations of the building, we had lovely plans and elevations of the buildings destroyed. It's not just a set that it stands there and people walk in and out. It goes through all these changes. We're going to see the plaza and Main Street all on fire.
In order to supply all the flames, each building has its own manifold system. It gets broken up into many, many different pipes to each window or doorway or roof. It's all kind of steel and hoses and cryogenic hoses and valves and normal valves and 2-ton gas tanks, 3-ton gas tanks, 5-ton gas trucks. It makes for a heavily propane-filled set.
There wasn't a lot of time up our sleeve that we could take weeks to change the set over into a destructive stage. So Tom Martin, our construction manager, came up with a genius idea of building the set in its destroyed stage first and then cladding it so that it was perfect to begin with. No crew member that wasn't there during the build process had any idea that the destroyed version was sitting underneath waiting to be revealed.
I took a little video for myself on my phone of the back streets, not even the main drag, the lanes, the offshoots, and the aged doors with tear stains of rust running down them. It absolutely looks like it's been there for hundreds and hundreds of years.
So there's loads of details. There's cornices and pillars and friezes, corbels, all over the set.
There's been a lot of scenic sculpture. We did a quite large relief plaque with the letter D quite prominent, you know, both Dan and David. So we had 2 of them, obviously.
From a set deck perspective, Deb wanted an authentic sort of place, so the shop fronts, you know, in the colour palette, all the doors, all the studs, you know, all that sort of detail. We wanted as real as possible.
It's shocking when you go behind one of these doors and you see scaffolding, because you really think you're in these places.
Nikolai and I said the other day, we'll never be on anything that is this vast ever again. They've built Croatia, and not like a street, they've built like 17 streets and alleys.
You needed a perspective to carry you through this horror. We thought Arya was the best person to use for that purpose.
I got a call from Miguel. Basically, I can't tell you anything, but you know what we did in Bob? I was like, yeah. He was like, we're going to do that, but with you. And I was like, okay.
It was meant to be ultimately come across as a 7.5-minute non-stop shot where we follow her on the run.
We practiced this many, many times. We've spent a whole day, 2 days practicing this shot already with Arya and with all the stunt team and all the extras we require.
It was originally shot to be this really long one-er, and it was actually a decision that Miguel and his editor Tim Porter made as they were cutting it, that intercutting the Clegane Bowl and Arya's escape was actually much more emotional and effective than having this 12-minute long one-er and then the fight as 2 separate pieces.
All she's left with is the sound of burning people and the smell of burning flesh. And she sees a white horse because it's symbolic and beautiful. And then she hops on and gallops off and makes it out of the city.
Thank you. The Battle of the Bastards is a giant vanity project by Benioff and Weiss to pander Kit Harington for an Emmy Award. They insisted on 70 live horses because they felt this enhanced his performance. Bizarre cited quotes from Benioff and Weiss support this, as do further descriptions of their original draft script that Sapochnik abandoned. And it's possible this battle doesn't even happen in the next novel. At all. That Stannis will defeat Ramsay. What I mean, Benioff, in the 30-minute behind-the-scenes video, it's the way he's ranting about the horses framing Harrington. Not just Jon Snow, but Harrington. Probably my favorite shot of the whole season is when we're behind Jon Snow, and he sees that cavalry wall galloping towards him. And part of the reason it's such a great shot is it's all real. That's 40 horses charging full speed at Kit Harington. In context of the way they were saying everything else, you seem really fixated on framing Kit Harington with those horses. And that's just what they filmed. I mean, when you hear what the original 42-day script was, Sapochnik, initially the idea was to almost never leave Jon's side ever. That's how the Oner was born. That's what they call it, that full 1 minute of the camera just following Jon. Out of the idea of what if you just stay on the ground with Jon. So, I don't know if it would all have been one continuous camera shot. They're not that crazy, but more so than in the final version, it would be this entire 20-minute segment of just Jon Snow in the camera, just Kit Harington in the camera, and with a lot more horses. So, cross-referencing these quotes, the original unfilmable draft script they gave Sapochnik, the 42-day one, was a giant version of that Oner shot. And also keep in mind, originally the melee with the pincers was going to involve horses. So, combine these two points, and it would have been a giant version of that Oner shot, heavy close combat, with Harrington fighting men on 70 live stunt horses in a melee crush. Just this mental image of Harrington framed by he's running in front of dying stunt horses, stage-falling stunt horses. That's what they really wanted. And the final one-minute version of the Oner took 2 days to film. How would you make 10 minutes of that? I don't know, but the camera is never leaving Jon, and well, Jon is Kit. But they had this mental image of a haggard, exhausted, mud-covered Harrington, and note I say Harrington, not Jon Snow, giving a big death glare performance. And such a strong performance, it would assuredly win him an Emmy Award. And in all, just listening to all of their interviews and commentaries, this is what they fix on. Pay attention. Wow, look at Kit's face. Look how haggard and dirty he is. They filmed in chronological order to get this, sacrificing the original ending. Time was prioritized for this, from other characters, even from Jon himself. And other comments that confirm this. A big tip-off for me. Weiss, also from the 30-minute behind-the-scenes bonus video. He announces, all of it is action, with almost no dialogue. Show off Maisie's big nonverbal emotive performance with her facial muscles. Either they felt this really was, at face value, enough to carry a scene like this, or they kind of half-filmed another thing with its fake Arya, then abandoned it because they felt Maisie's performance can carry it anyway. Each one had the same reason. Arya, the fictional character in this, has ceased to exist. This is their moneymaker. Celebrity actors' faces contextlessly mugging for the camera. Just shoving characters into positions because we want them to do this. They still express this in subsequent reviews. Even through the end of season 6, Linda will say they sure wanted that character to do that. And so did I for a time. I, through the end of season 6, until I saw the Blu-rays, kept thinking they just have a warped view of that fictional character. And increasingly through her reviews, because this is circulating amongst the online fandom now, people keep talking about they wanted that moment, capital M. They want these moments, that they wanted a cool Arya moment. That's how they describe it. And that's what I disagree with. They're wrong. This big hysterical laughing scene is not a, quote, Arya moment. It is a Maisie Williams moment, showing off that Maisie, the actor, can laugh on cue like that, emote on cue. Okay, getting a little philosophical here. This is not a pipe. It is an artistic drawing representing a pipe. What you have in front of you now is a digital screen with pixels on it showing the image of a pipe. This isn't a pipe, a three-dimensional object. The pipe doesn't really exist. It's fictional. It's representing a pipe. This is not Arya. It is never going to be Arya in any context, even season one. I'm saying Arya Stark is a fictional character. She doesn't exist in reality. She's a book character. So what we see here is Maisie the actor in an Arya costume. We have to take that mental step back as we're so in-universe when we're thinking of it. Watching Maisie on set in front of cameras, Benioff and Weiss wanted to see her giving a great emotive performance laughing, with no attempt to explain what sense it made for Arya, the fictional character. They didn't do this because they wanted to see Arya laughing. Direct comparison. Just as the Arya randomly laughing scene is really just showing off Maisie emoting, the chase scene is the same thing, showing off Maisie, with no thought to even TV Arya as this separate fictional character in a different continuity. There is no continuity. There is no fictional character. They took it to such an extreme as just celebrity actors in costumes mugging for the camera. This is awful. At least it won't affect her ongoing storylines, is what I'm telling myself, but it, in many ways, shot 2 years' worth of buildup. People who were ignoring, the Sansa rape stuff, let's ignore that. Let's ignore Dorne. We don't like them. They're not the people we're attached to. Let's ignore Stannis. Arya, who's one of the really core cast members that people are, she's still having a great time. Even her storyline. End of season 5, we were warning they're ruining Dorne, Stannis, and Sansa. What if this creeps into ruining other storylines? And people just wave that aside. Oh yeah, like they'd ever ruin the Arya storyline. They did something really stupid in the Arya storyline, and in many ways it specifically cost Maisie Williams an Emmy Award.
I got a call from Miguel. Basically, I can't tell you anything, but you know what we did in Bob? I was like, yeah. He was like, we're going to do that, but with you. And I was like, okay.
It was meant to be ultimately come across as a 7.5-minute non-stop shot where you follow her on the run.
It was originally shot to be this really long one-er, and it was actually a decision that Miguel and his editor Tim Porter made as they were cutting it, that intercutting the Clegane Bowl and Arya's escape was actually much more emotional and effective than having this 12-minute long one-er and then the fight as two separate pieces.
Of course she is. And she's wondering what trap you're laying for her.
Shall we?
Again, one of those scenes I read and thought, wow, this is long. But you got these actors, these faces, and this material. And when you guys make it look so beautiful.
And most of all, these performances, these faces, the fireworks of these actors, two of our finest actors in the cast playing off each other.